Last week we talked about getting old. How many remember that last week? I'm trying to check out your memory. You know, can you remember? We were here last week.
Yep, I was here last week.
It's talked about old age, and it was actually a time of gathered wisdom, old age.
Oh, yeah.
How do you gather wisdom? Through experience and life skills. How can you tell that you're getting old? Well, you all of a sudden have this great abundance of gray hair. And what you do, you don't get rid of it. You really do, except for all that Lady Clairol and
everything.
Men, just for men, and all this.
I wouldn't know anything about that.
So, it flourishes as a time where it just keeps growing, growing, growing. Always coming back great, so we say that the time of black hair is the time of fun, excitement, vitality, get after it. Because in your lifespan, the time of black hair is a short life, it's a short day. Mm-hmm. You can't go back and relive that short day. Mm-hmm. If you didn't jump and was quick like a grasshopper back in that short period when you had black hair, and you get gray hair, there ain't no way in the world you're going to experience. So, the Bible says, remember the Lord in the days of your youth, the days mm-hmm. of black hair. Because when you get old and gray,
yeah.
you won't be able to jump around and move, because you might have some grievances in the day of gray hair. You just can't experience. I can't get up and do stuff as quick as I used to. So, remember the Lord in the days of your youth. Honor Him, serve Him real good back in those days.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you call the time under the sun, black hair days. It's the time under the sun. You get everything that you can think about. And your strength is in your arms and your legs. And that's in the days of black hair, your strength is in your arms and your legs. And in old age, you become like a, where was that? But in old age, your legs don't carry you and your arms don't carry you. You become a burden. Everybody else has to carry you. Mm-hmm. They have to open the door for you because it takes forever for you to get through the door. Wheelchairs, canes, 12:3 in Ecclesiastes 12:3. In the day when the keepers of the house shall tremble, that's your legs. The keepers of your house, your body is your legs. They start mm-hmm. trembling. They get weak. Strong men bow themselves. That's your upper body is bowing down. And the grinders cease because they are few, and those that look out of the windows be darkened. That's your eyes. Your eyes get dim. You have to start wearing glasses. Read. If it was enough light in here, I wouldn't need these glasses. But just not enough light, so I have to get some help. You would think, well, that's normal light. But if I stepped outside with this book, I could see it. But and you get old, you don't enjoy music like you used to. Yeah, like Sister Shirley's granddaughter probably. Y'all got two different kinds of music that y'all like. What's wrong with Grandma? She can't get rid of it. She's old. She can't keep up with it.
That's a soft music.
She's like soft and slow. That's what I asked. That's what's going on. Okay. So now we're going to, that's the wisdom of the elf. You're getting old. With this gray hair comes life skills, and experiences, and you pretty much can deal with life because you've seen a lot. And that's what the beauty of old age is. If you're blessed to get the gray hair, let it rip. Wisdom is let it rip. It means you've been around a while. Okay. Praise God. Okay, now we're going to talk today about a subject for mature audiences. It's not PG-13 today. Not G. This might be triple X territory. Song of Solomon. I might need to be excused. Song of Solomon. It's a good lesson to give to the young people growing up, and I would say when you start this lesson, you start this lesson about the age of that baby up there. Both boys and girls. Mm-hmm. Start this is a good lesson to pick up then. It can apply any time, and it's good to pick it up any time, but the more it is instilled, the more value you'll find in a lesson like this. Most of society, I don't care in any dispensation, did not see it like Solomon saw it. They perverted God's blessings to mankind. Most of, and even Solomon himself, perverted God's blessing between man and woman himself because of, he had so many marriages. First Kings 11, you can get there. So Solomon himself, he may have been in love at one time with one particular woman. Really did experience this from the depth of his heart. But it was diluted and perverted and everything else because of so many marriages. 1 Kings 11. I'm just going to protect myself by going by the word today. Chapter 11, 1 through 3. I'm hiding in the word. It's right here in the word. Okay, Sister Candy, can you read that? Someone who feels like reading it.
Solomon loved many strange women. Together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonians, and Hittites.
Mm-hmm.
And the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, you shall not go into them, neither shall they come into you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Solomon clave unto these in love.
Ooh.
And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart.
His wives turned away his heart from pursuing his God, from adhering to the statutes, the principles, the covenants, the agreements of his God, the invisible God. Solomon loved many strange women, it says. And what do we mean by that? Women that were not of his culture. He had the money, and he liked to travel. It's like if we in our day go to Japan, Germany, all over the world, and just see all of these different cultures and different women. And that's what he liked. He liked different people. Mm-hmm. Even locally here, you can find different cultures. You can find the Indian culture, the Latino culture, Anglo culture, African culture, and a guy who can just make himself a great old world around here. I know all different cultures, and I like all different women. And the nations concerning, that's why verse 2 says, of the nations concerning which the Lord said unto the children of Israel, you should not go into them. In other words, you should not have intimate relationship with any of these people, any of these women. Because you're going to get so close to them that their habits, their customs, their practices are going to turn you away from what you should be doing, that relationship that you and I should have. And Solomon, he didn't care. He just liked all those different kinds of women, different cultures. And they did. That's what verse 3 said. That's what happened.
Verse 4, he explained it even more.
Okay, what happened?
It came to pass when Solomon was old that his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of his father David.
So, that's what Solomon, that's what all his money and Cadillacs and everything got him. A whole bunch of women that turned away his heart from God. Okay, so, true intimate relationship between a man and a woman, between a girl and a boy. Pick it up. First thing, when should it happen? When you're young. Adding in the word, brother. When you're young. He's writing about a young man finding a young woman. This is what this particular scripture is. A young man has found a young woman, mm-hmm. whom his heart has just been swept away by this young woman. And this is a legitimate picture of how God wants a man and a woman to meet up and carry on and come to the conclusion of marriage. This is the perfect picture in the Bible of God's perfect plan for a man and a woman, how they meet up and get together intimately. So, let's see. What's happening? What's happening? Okay. Yeah, first of all, we're going to find that love expressed needs to be reciprocated. This guy finds this girl, and this girl responds back. If you're like me, you got to go through like 40 or 50 of them. Just keep dialing until someone will answer your call. No. just keep trying to somebody to flirt back with you. this is Solomon. He found one that so he's looking for love to come back to him. He's putting it out and he's looking for it to come back to him. Well, that's the ground rules for love. Love given out, love has to be reciprocated. Mm-hmm. And that's why Jesus says, if you love me, you can show it by responding back. And we all know how that is. So the young bride does respond back. She does respond back. We're going to find out in our lesson. And she offers all she has to her lover. Mm-hmm. Lover. Keep that in mind here in a little bit, because this is for mature audiences. So, here's a book about a man and a woman, mm-hmm. about love between a man and a woman. This is the Song of Solomon. It's a book written about a man and a woman, love between a man and a woman, and the garden of the greater love Christ has for us, his church. All right, now let's look at the lesson and see what we come up with. There's a dialogue going on in the Song of Solomon, the 4th chapter, verse 8. Dialogue, conversation. Mm-hmm. Conversation. Let's see what's going on there. Someone read it. Who's mature? Not shy.
Come with me from Lebanon, my son. With me from Lebanon. Look from the top of Amana, from the top of Shania, and from On, and from the lion's den, and from the mountains of the Lebanon.
Okay, he says, come with me from Lebanon. Mm-hmm. Come with me from Lebanon. It says from Lebanon. Lebanon is a country, even up today, old ancient country. But it was means that the girl that he found is well experienced. She's worldly. She's not no dummy or anything. She's sure of herself. She's been places. Come with me from Lebanon, my what? Spouse. Mm-hmm. With me from Lebanon, look from the top of Amana, which is a mountain, okay, from the top of Shinar, which is another mountain, and Hermon, which is another, even today, mm-hmm. it's another famous mountain. And then, so from the lion's dens, from the mountains of the leopards. In other words, he's getting a world-class good-looking. He's looking at this girl. Ooh, man, she's been around. She's smart, educated, been places. So from, come with me. You got all that experience, but now I want you to come to me. Mm-hmm. Solomon. Williams, North Tulsa. Mm-hmm. Come. Answer the phone. I'm calling you. I know you're classy. You know, answer my call, will you? I'm calling on you. That's what he wants her to do, to answer him. Mm-hmm. Is that how it goes, brothers?
Yeah, that's how it goes.
Call? So, go by, knock on the door, respond. You know, look, notice me. So, verse 9. What it says this? Verse 9.
Thou hast ravished my heart, my sister, my spouse. Thou hast ravished my heart with one of thine eyes, with one chain of thy neck.
Okay, so actually now they have actually went through the courtship, verse 8 and verse 9. They have went through the courtship, and it's the wedding night. They have actually left the altar and forgot about everybody that was at church. They were sitting there waiting. It's between you and me now, baby. They shut out everybody.
They don't know. Badass out.
Forgot about the wedding gifts and everything else. So he says, now come with me into my world. Mm-hmm. He says, thou hast ravished my heart. In other words, I have lost all common sense now. All my reasoning is out the window. It's just you and me. We went through all the courtship period and everything. It's just you and me. Nobody else. So he's got his love with him. Verse 8 calls him my spouse, my wife. Thou hast ravished my heart. I can't even keep a straight mind now. I'm lost in love. And he calls her my sister, my spouse. In other words, when he says my sister, it means it's like you would treat your sister with respect. Mm-hmm. I respect you, but you sure got a fine body. Look at them thighs. Woo! Wow. But I was. I respect you. Now, this is the. This day. I'm telling you why I didn't worry now. So, this day and age, men do not what? Respect women. See it in the songs. That they sing.
They show it on.
You hear it. The rap and all that. They just don't respect them. They don't see them as they say. I would never say that to my sister.
Right. I'm telling you.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? I got three of them. I treated all of them with respect.
That's right.
You know, so when I get my girl, he's saying, you know, oh, yeah, she's my sister. I got to respect her too. Mm-hmm. I know them some nice. So, she sure inspired though, but I'm respecting her. Mm-hmm. Okay, praise God. So that's what it says. Now, I'm losing control. Ooh, oh, she's my sister. Oh, I got to respect her. And then it says, my spouse. That's mine. That's what he's saying. I respect her, and she's mine. Mm-hmm. So, thou hast ravished my heart with one of thine what?
Eyes.
Ooh, I just looked at one of your eyes. Seeing me crazy. Is this guy in love? He's in love. He's in love, and what's going on? His emotional man is dragging his physical man into intimacy. He's on fire. This is God's design. This is God working with this dude. Ooh, man, I'm on fire. All right. So, for a man to get into this state of mind like this has two purposes. Two purposes. One is to procreate, bring other more people into the world, be fruitful and do what?
Multiply.
That's one reason why he's in this state. And the other state is that he's in this is because God says, it's all yours, buddy. Have a ball. Because I love you. I want you in this emotional state. I want you driven with this kind of passion for your spouse. Bless your heart. Have a ball. So, that's where we get to Hebrews 13 and 14. This is the New Testament now. And I have to fight preachers on this verse all the time. Because William didn't come from that old traditional school. He just picked up the words just before. I ain't from no Kojic, I ain't from no Assembly of God. little bit of Baptist. But none of that teaching mattered until I got into the Word. Hebrews 13 and 4. I'm sorry, what does it read?
13 and 4. Marriage is honorable and all.
Marriage is honorable. It's a good thing to be in that kind of state.
Yes, it is.
Anytime with your spouse.
And the bed undefiled.
In the bedroom, the bed is undefiled. So this guy is saying that his mind is just gone with this fine sister. And whatever he can imagine, here we go. Because he's been through courtship and everything else. And now he's with his girl. So what's it say, Candy?
Marriage is honorable and all.
Marriage is honorable and all.
And the bed undefiled.
The bed is undefiled.
Whoremongers and adulterers, God
will judge.
So he's in a perfect union and state of mind that God wants him to be. Mm-hmm. It's honorable. It's honor. So what he told Adam and Eve, that's how I want y'all to be around each other. So you can be fruitful and multiply. Okay, so that's where we go. Okay, any comments? Ravish my heart. So far I've only looked at one eye of yours. So one eye. I even got you the rest of your anatomy. Just one eye. Man, that's some nice eyelids you got there. So, okay. All right. With one chain on thy neck. Mm-hmm. In other words, as he's removing the attire, he says, oh, now we get down to this necklace you're wearing. Ooh, that sure does kind of get you. He's moving, ain't he, Brother Al?
I believe in course.
Yeah, Bray White. Put on a Bray White record. Here we go. Verse 10. Mature audience, this is only.
How fair is thy love, my sister, my spouse?
All right.
How much better is thy love than wine? Ooh. And the smell of thy ointments than all spices.
Man. He's sniffing around her body.
Oh my goodness.
Well, it's cold-blooded. How wonderful is your love? And he's doing it what? Respectfully. Mm-hmm. My sister. See, respectfully. Then he says, my spouse. And if I was in a men's class, men's group, I would go into more detail. Brothers, this is how you touch a woman. Then I have to charge him too. This is how you touch a woman. Well, really, yeah. There's really no place on her body that she doesn't want you to touch her. It's just how you're touching her. It's the problem. Whew. Oh, Sister Hill was here. Oh, there she is. Mature audiences. So, how fair is my love? Oh, how wonderful you are. He says, my sister is still treating her with respect. Then he says, my spouse. In other words, this is you and me, a husband and wife. Okay. Now, and then he says, you're better than what? Than wine. Check it out. Anybody ever drunk some wine?
Better than wine.
Nobody's ever drunk no wine in here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I gotta find me a church, you know. Better than wine. In other words, you know, a glass of wine kind of lay you back. Chill you out. Everything's cool. No anxieties.
Feeling no pain.
Yeah, just chill for a while. so relaxed. Nobody's nervous. What an atmosphere. Thrones are very well. How much better is our love? In other words, just being with you puts me in a state better than a glass of wine. And the smell of thine what? Than all spices. So this brother is definitely sniffing around. The smell of his wife. Back of her ear, hair. Just close, intimate. So he's not acting like a dog in heat, but he's
close.
Yeah, he's close. I mean, he's feeling it. He's feeling it, you know. But he's just, you know, he's cool. And not only that, he is, if I was in a men's class, teaching a men's class, not have to charge for this, but he is what? Verbal.
Verbal.
There's a dialogue going on. He's talking. Brother's got it going on. He's cold-blooded. He's like a Barry Wright record. Yeah, Brother Kirby, he's like Barry Wright. Temptations. I don't know what kind of song Temptations. That really got a couple of songs they have. Okay. You remember anything, Brother? What was it?
Teddy Pendergrass.
Teddy Pendergrass, okay. Yeah. Yeah. Just, he's rapping to her. He's getting her into the mood like the snake did Eve. Talking to her. So, and he said over there in Hebrews 13 and 4, this is the way you do it. This is the way you do it. Okay, so verse 11.
Thy lips are my spouse, drop as the honeycomb. Mm. Honey and milk are under thy tongue. And the smell of thy garments is like the smell of Lebanon.
Like the smell of Lebanon. Lebanon has known for the big trees, mm-hmm. the cedars, and nice pleasant smell. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then he says, but this brother is not just sitting in a chair talking. He is so intimate. Thy lips, means he must have tasted her lips. Probably not that loud. Oh, my spouse. Oh, my girl. So he got to be close to know that those lips are like what? Honeycomb.
Honeycomb. Mm-hmm. Honey and milk.
And then he says, you like that land God promised us. This is exactly what God promises, a land flowing with milk and honey.